ancient Egypt. For millennia, it has captured the imaginations, hearts, and minds of generations of truth seekers, eager to know who really built the pyramids, when they were built, and why they were built.
This documentary series is comprehensive. It's the biggest documentary series ever made about ancient Egypt. This documentary series will not only rewrite the history of ancient Egypt, it will turn the history of the human race upside down. So come with me as we go down the Nile and we discover the truth beneath the sands of Egypt. I was a child, I had a fascination with ancient Egypt. Any book, any documentary, I watched it, I read everything. But every time I saw it or I read it, something about what the Egyptologists were telling me didn't ring true. And for years and years and years, like a big jigsaw puzzle, I tried to put the pieces together. And I tried to put them together the way the Egyptologists had them. But the picture didn't make sense. And then I came to Egypt and I saw the evidence for myself. And the picture started to take a different shape. This documentary series is comprehensive. It's the biggest documentary series ever made about ancient Egypt. Not only is the biggest, but it's the most controversial. We took a camera. We went around Egypt, we went to places we weren't allowed to go, we couldn't get into, and we filmed what we weren't supposed to film. Because we're shooting off the grid, we've had to sneak into some of these sites with small handheld cameras. So some of the footage is not going to be as beautiful as you might see on a BBC documentary. It may be grainy, but we've got it. But it's going to show what's there. We didn't create this documentary with a huge budget. We didn't create this documentary with nice reconstructions, with romanticized stories. We created this documentary series with the evidence. And the evidence was telling us a different story about ancient Egypt. In this documentary series, you're going to get new insights into who built the pyramids, when they were built, how they were built, new insights into who Jesus really was and why the Catholic Church don't want you to know the truth. You're going to discover who Mary Magdalene really was and why the Catholic Church have obliterated her from the Bible. You're going to find out who Moses really was and the origins of Judaism and what really happened at the time of the Exodus. I'm going to show you who the gods were, or rather, who the gods really are. This documentary series will not only rewrite the history of ancient Egypt, it will turn the history of the human race upside down. So come with me as we go down the Nile and we discover the truth beneath the sands of Egypt.
Egypt. The name is a corruption of the ancient late Egyptian Hekupta, Memphis, meaning home of the Ka, or soul of Ptah, the name of a temple to the god Ptah at Memphis. The ancient Egyptian name of the country was Kemet, which means black ground or black soil, referring to the fertile black soils of the Nile floodplains.
For most of my life, I've been fascinated by ancient Egypt. And if you're watching this series of documentaries, then you've probably got a similar fascination. But for me, as much as I was excited watching everything, there were bits and pieces of what the Egyptologists were telling me that didn't fit together. They didn't make sense. Now, I'm not putting down the Egyptologists. I think they do a fantastic job. But something about it was bothering me. And I don't have a professorship. I don't have a degree in Egyptology or archaeology. And sometimes that can be a disadvantage because it means that you don't get access to the documents. You don't get access to the inner workings of the temples that are barred to people. But it also can be an advantage because it means I'm not conditioned by what my predecessors have said. And let's understand something. Everything about ancient Egypt is conjecture. It's guesswork. It's not factual. There are no real documents. There are no real exposés that say this is definitely how it was. Everything is being interpreted. Everything is being guessed at. And it doesn't matter if you have a degree or not. Anyone can make guesses as to how the pieces of the puzzle fit together. You see, Egyptology is a relatively new branch of archaeology, having its beginnings back in the 1850s and really only truly being recognized with the work of Flinders Petrie in the late 19th century, before definitely establishing itself in the early 20th century with Howard Carter's discovery of Tutankhamun's tomb. Because there is no definitive contemporary encyclopedia on ancient Egypt, Egyptology was, and still is, a science of guesstimates. So there will probably always be discrepancies of dates, periods, dynasties, names, spelling, and all else to do with the proposed facts on ancient Egypt. Let me repeat that so it's absolutely clear. There is no direct evidence of any kind as to the structure or dates of ancient Egypt. It's all pure conjecture by the Egyptologists.
The pieces of the puzzle are all there. They always have been. The question is, have they been put together in an intelligent, informed, and methodical process based on all the evidence?
Or have they just been thrown together in a slapdash manner, resulting in a distorted history that's deliberately misleading us from the truth? Maybe there's a definite agenda going on. An agenda that has its roots way back in ancient Egypt, but is being perpetuated through history by the bureaucracies and secret societies of today's Illuminati. Is that too far-fetched? Let's wait and see. In this first episode, what I'm going to do is I'm going to lay down the foundations for you for the whole series, because it's important that we know not only where we're going, but where we start. And in laying down the foundations, I'm going to look at the key elements of ancient Egypt, explain what the Egyptologists or the scientists believe to be true, and how that is going to take us into different directions. We have to know where we've started before we know where we're going. That's what this episode is all about. Now, I'm not a religious person, but it would be remiss of me if I didn't look at the influences of religion throughout ancient Egypt. Firstly, we'll be looking at the religions of ancient Egypt, the gods. Why did they revere certain gods and certain stars? Then we're going to look at the origins of Judaism and who Moses really was and what was the story of the Exodus. That will lead us through into the origins of Christianity, and particularly looking at who Jesus really was and what his connection was to ancient Egypt. That will mean that we'll be extending that to go into who Mary Magdalene was and what was the significance of her role in his ministry. Then there's the period after the crucifixion and how Christianity developed. That will take us through into looking to Islam and where Islam really drew its roots from, and then also to the significance of the Vedic teachings and the Hindu and the Buddhist teachings that permeate religious thought. So we're going to have a very broad view and see how these have their connections to ancient Egypt. There are answers waiting to be found in Egypt, and most of those answers lie beneath the sand. And I'm going to go back and look at this evidence with my own eyes. I'm going to show you the actual physical evidence, and we're going to see how the pieces fit together and whether they fit together differently, and whether we come to a different conclusion based on the evidence. Because if the pieces don't fit together the way the Egyptologists tell us, then there must be some other answer. Now, the answers that we might come to, the Egyptologists may not agree with. You may not agree with them either. But if they make sense and they can't be disproven, then we have to look at them seriously. And if they plug all those gaps that the Egyptologists can't plug, then maybe we need to have a really good look at what the true history of ancient Egypt is.
Located in the northeast corner of the continent of Africa and connected to the southwest corner of Asia via a land bridge formed by the Sinai Peninsula, modern-day Egypt is bordered by the Gaza Strip and Israel to the northeast, the Gulf of Aqaba to the east, the Red Sea to the east and south, Sudan to the south, Libya to the west, and bound by the Mediterranean Sea to the north. Throughout history, because of various invasions and conquests, its borders have changed. But what is more important in the scope of this documentary series is that Egypt wasn't always where it is today. For instance, because of continental drift, it is currently drifting northwards about 2 centimeters per year.
When we look at the geography of Egypt, we have to be very careful that we don't just assume that what is there now is what was there 5,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago, or even 1,000 years ago. We know that because of continental drift, Africa is moving northward. The scientists are very, very clear about the fact that there is continental drift. But they've never really explained what causes continental drift. Yes, the continents all sit on this band of magma around the planet and things move, but something has to cause that to move. The magma may well be flowing, but does it really move the continent? Or is there some other thing at work? We know, according to the Egyptologists, that originally all of the continents fitted together as one continent called Pangaea. But have they explained to us why our planet was formed with just one continent, with one bump and all the rest of it water? The planet, of course, that way would be lopsided. Why did it form lopsided? Well, that's something we're going to have a look at. If we look at the moon, the moon is moving away from the Earth about 2 or 3 centimeters a year. Now that tells us something. If we keep winding back the clock, there was a time when the moon was attached to the Earth. And as confirmation for that, the barycenter of the orbits is thousands of kilometers inside the crust of the Earth, meaning they had to have been at one point the same object. The fact that the moon is moving away means that at one point it was closer, and if you keep winding the clock back, they had to have been together as one. The evidence is overwhelming that the two objects were once one object. It explains why that land bridge of Pangaea was formed. As the moon pulled away, it left the blob there that formed Pangaea. There is lots of evidence supporting that. There is nothing that does not support that. That is a theory that stands testing. So we have to look at that seriously as to how Pangaea formed. What sort of evidence can we look to support the fact that the moon and the Earth were once the same object? Well, when they went to the moon, and that's another thing that we're going to talk about later in the series, did they go to the moon? Did they not go to the moon? What is it with the film footage? Well, we're going to have a really good look at that. But when they came back from the moon, the samples that they brought back were identical to samples on the Earth. The rocks were one and the same age, the same composition, everything about them was the same, which showed they came from the same source.
So we know that the moon and the earth are part of the original one rock structure. Now, the moon doesn't orbit the earth. The two of them orbit each other, which means at one time in the past, these two objects must have been joined together as one. Now, it makes sense then that as they're spinning around, they would start to pull apart, and when they finally break free, it would leave a bump of land on one side, which over time, as it spins and turns, would start to settle down and try to balance itself. That's the only theory to me that makes sense as to why we would have an unbalanced planet with just one continent on one side. How the Earth formed and the Moon formed, well, that's another question. And when it formed is another question, which we're going to look at later on in the series. But for now, we're just going to look at the geography of the planet. Because if we've got one bump on the side, what caused that bump to then break up? Why did the planet want to balance itself by moving the continents around? And what was the cause that allowed that to happen? It can't just happen by magic. Something has to happen. Now, you've got rotational energy, but rotational energy will keep that piece on one side. It will be lopsided. Like your tire, if it's out of balance when you're driving, if it's unbalanced, it will keep doing that. But something happened that caused the Earth to balance itself, for these continents to move apart. And we're going to investigate that later on in the series. But at some point, these pieces did break up and move around the planet. And Africa has shifted to different places and different times. We don't know exactly when. Everything to do with science is a guess. There's no measuring sticks that can say, oh yes, we know this for a fact. They say the dinosaurs lived 500 million years ago, 200 million years ago. How do they know that? They say, well, because we found the dinosaur bones in rocks that were 20 million years old. Well, how do you know the rocks were 20 million years old? Because we found dinosaur bones in them. It's circular illogic. We can't be 100% sure of the datings that we are being given. Carbon dating is unreliable. Everything is guesstimates. So we have to look at this geology of Egypt. Where actually was it in ancient Egypt? Are there any clues that can tell us where it was situated? There are. And later on in the series, we're going to show you that evidence. Clear evidence that Egypt, whilst it may have been generally in the same location, was actually in a very different orientation. There is lots of evidence that says Egypt was not where it is today. The question then arises, well, what caused it to move? On the bigger scale, if we look at Egypt from space, what we see are these massive water flow patterns. We see that at some point, huge amounts of water have passed over Egypt, and that water has drained back or drained out in certain directions. And the evidence of that is everywhere. It's carved out passageways. Because once water comes onto somewhere, it has to find a way out. And it usually carves out passageways. And we find the evidence for that everywhere in Egypt. The question is, when did that happen? How did the Earth and the moon become that one object that must have been molten enough and fluid enough for it to pull apart? How did that happen? We'll look at that later in the series, because that really does change the ball game. Because it explains why Pangaea broke up. It explains the asteroid impacts that have hit the Earth periodically and wiped out various aspects of life on the planet. And life on the planet is something that we're going to have a look at as well. Evolution. Evolution is a theory. It is a theory that does not stand examination. There are hundreds of examples that prove that evolution cannot have happened on this planet the way that the scientists tell us. Proper scientific practice says if you find evidence that disproves a theory, the theory cannot stand. Evolution cannot stand. We'll go into the evidence later on in the series. The geography of this planet is continually shifting. The geography of Egypt is continually shifting. And clues to that can be found in the geology of Egypt. And that's what we're going to look at next.
With over 90 million inhabitants, Egypt is the most populous country in the Middle East. However, despite having an area of over 1 million square kilometers, the majority of Egypt's landscape is desert, with a few oases scattered about. Therefore, due to the extreme aridity of Egyptian climate, the great majority of its people are concentrated in an area of about 40,000 square kilometers along the narrow Nile Valley and Delta, where the only arable land is found, meaning that about 99% of the population uses about 5.5% of the total land area. Large regions of the Sahara and Libyan desert, where winds create prolific sand dunes that peak at more than 100 feet or 30 meters, constitute most of Egypt's territory and are sparsely inhabited.
Because of all the political upheaval that was happening in Egypt, my friends and associates said to me when I was planning to go and film this documentary series, they said I had rocks in my head. Well, that was really appropriate because it was the rocks of Egypt that were really calling me back, because the rocks are the real evidence of what has happened geologically in Egypt. Most of these rocks are volcanic, and there is a massive volcano under the whole Mediterranean. It affects Mount Etna, it affects Mount Vesuvius, it affected Thera back in 1600, and that massive supervolcano still has an influence in Egypt. Where we see the evidence of that is in the rocks that comprise Egypt, not just the sand that covers most of Egypt. And that's another thing that we'll look at. The sand, where did it come from? We traditionally associate sand with being in the ocean. And if that's the case, if that's where sand is formed, if that's where sand normally is located, then what happened to dump billions of tons of sand onto Egypt? Because as we've said, Egypt was volcanic. We find lots of this magnificent stone, red granite, in Aswan. What's the significance of red granite? Why is it that the ancient Egyptians chose such a hard stone to work? How did they create 400 ton smoothly cut, polished sarcophaguses, columns, and then transport them? Not just the red granite, but also the grey granite, the black granite. What was the difference? Why did they specifically use these stones? What is so special about the limestone formations that we find in Egypt? where we find them, how we find them, and what the ancient Egyptians did with those limestone foundations. That's what we need to look at. The limestone that forms the Giza Plateau and forms many parts of Egypt. When I was younger, I believed that limestone was formed by all of these marine creatures dying off, falling to the bottom of the ocean, and then the pressure creating the limestone, and that this process took hundreds of thousands of years. That's not true. I found out that limestone was created in shallow lakes by these marine creatures dying off, and that thicknesses of 800 meters could be dumped in the space of a couple of years. So how does that affect our belief about the limestone structures of Egypt, the Giza Plateau, the White Desert? When were these formations actually made? They didn't take millions of years. They didn't take hundreds of thousands of years. They could have happened over 10, 15, 20 years. We need to look at that really closely. And what about the limestone formations? What about the Giza Plateau? What does that tell us? It tells us that at some point that level was below sea level. It was a lake. There was a lake on top of it. And something has happened which has lifted that limestone after it's been formed up above the sea to where it is now. We're talking major geological activity. And then you find the evidence in Egypt. You find fossilized shells. And then above them, ones that aren't fossilized. Seashells. Hundreds of miles inland. What's the significance between all of this? And what about the sandstone? Sandstone tells us that those layers of sand were then compressed. So water came on top again. What do we see in Egypt? We see the evidence of lots of water inundating the country, it being buried for periods, limestone forming, it being lifted at other periods above the ground, lots of geological and tectonic activity going on in Egypt. When? That's the question. Most of Egypt is covered in black volcanic rock. These small fragments, as well as massive basalt sheets, which shows that not only was there flowing lava at some stage, but all of these incredible little pieces were blown up into the sky and like dust fell over vast parts of Egypt. When did that happen if these are still scattering the surface on top of the sand, not under the sand? This volcanic activity did not happen first and then the sand come over the top of it. The sand came over it and then all of this fell on top. We have a chronology. We haven't looked at it. The evidence is right there in front of us. Something was going on in Egypt that changed the landscape, and it changed it dramatically. The final aspect of the geology of Egypt that I want to look at is this preoccupation with gold. Why is it that the ancient Egyptians were so preoccupied with gold? Let's understand that gold is not a very easy substance to acquire. It usually requires incredible amounts of mining deep in the ground to find, to get out, and then it has to go through a rather extraordinary process for it to be purified. And at the end of that process, what you finish up with is a very malleable, soft metal that's not really usable for making any tools, but it looks pretty. So if the ancient Egyptians were so uncivilized that they basically had just come out of being hunter-gatherers into being agricultural people, why did they expend so much time and effort to find a substance that has no practical use for them, other than to make pretty jewelry? And why is it that gold mines have been discovered in South Africa 200,000 years old? What's this preoccupation with gold? What's really behind it? Does it have something to do with monoatomic gold? Monoatomic gold is what happens to gold when you put it through a particular process where it loses its structure and becomes a white powder. And that powder has incredible properties. Who knows? Perhaps the reason that they wanted the gold was to turn it into monoatomic gold so that they could levitate all of these massive blocks. Perhaps. But there's also reference to the fact that they used to eat this manna for the purposes of enlightening themselves, stimulating their pineal glands, and for prolonging their age. Is that the real reason that they wanted this monoatomic gold? Or is it just one of the reasons? And if it was, the question has to be asked, how did they superheat it and convert it from its normal state into this monoatomic state? Because that would require considerable technology. Is that the real reason and clue behind the Egyptian preoccupation with gold? We'll look at that in another episode. Let's turn our thinking now to the history of ancient Egypt. And to do that, let's start with a conventional perspective on ancient Egypt. Let's start with what the Egyptologists accept as the given.
Considered a cradle of civilization, Egypt has one of the longest histories of any modern-day country, with ancient Egypt producing some of the earliest developments of writing, agriculture, urbanization, organized religion, and central government in history. In the 10th millennium BC, a culture of hunter-gatherers and fishers was replaced by a grain-grinding culture. However, either climate changes or overgrazing around 8000 BC began to desiccate the pastoral lands of Egypt, forming the Sahara. As a result, the early tribes migrated to the Nile River, where they developed a settled agricultural economy and more centralized society. At about 6000 BC, the Neolithic era, several pre-dynastic cultures developed independently in Upper and Lower Egypt, and a Neolithic culture was firmly rooted in the Nile Valley. The earliest known site in Lower Egypt was Merimde, which was followed about 700 years later by the Upper Egyptian Bedarian culture and the successor Naqada series, generally regarded as precursors to dynastic Egypt. The contemporaneous Lower Egyptian communities coexisted with their Upper Egyptian counterparts for more than 2,000 years, remaining culturally distinct but maintaining frequent contact through trade until a unified kingdom was founded around 3150 BC by King Menes or Nama. The Nama palette, discovered in 1898 by James Kibel and Frederick Green, amongst a collection of ceremonial objects, including fragments of a ceremonial mace head belonging to Nama and some other mace head fragments inscribed with the name of one of Nama's predecessors, the Horus Scorpion, all ritually buried within an early temple of the falcon god Horus, at the site of the ancient pre-dynastic capital of Hieraconopolis in the south of Egypt.
Now, according to the Egyptologists, the Nama palette represents the unification of Upper and Lower Egypt by Nama or Menes in the first dynasty. But there are no hieroglyphics as such on the palette, only raised reliefs, and most of those are of the pharaoh about to cave some poor menial skull in. It's a good indication that early Egypt, around the time of the first dynasty, was definitely not a land of milk and honey.
Dating to around 3100 BC, the Nama palette is possibly the earliest example of hieroglyphic inscriptions, making it one of the most important artifacts from the dawn of ancient Egyptian civilization, and so valuable that it has never been permitted to leave Egypt. The beautifully carved shield-shaped ceremonial plate, a little over 2 feet high and made of smooth grayish-green siltstone or schist, was decorated on both faces with detailed low reliefs showing a series of ambitious scenes that have been difficult to interpret and have resulted in a number of theories regarding their meaning, with a satisfactory interpretation on the scene still elusive. In addition, the exact circumstances surrounding the discovery of the palette were not noted, and there appears to be some contradiction in the publication of Kibel's work, putting further doubt on the identity and content of the Nama palette. The top of each side of the palette is decorated in similar manner. The name of the king inscribed in a so-called serek, perhaps an early form of cartouche, framed by two thrones or palaces and set between two bovine heads.
Is the serek the name of the king, or is it the title, like the title of a newspaper, stuck at the top? The palette being a way to promote the news of the day. And were the two bulls symbols of the representation of Hathor? If so, why? Or do they have some other as yet unknown significance?
Beneath the headers, one side of the palette is dominated by the image of a king wearing the white crown of Upper Egypt and holding a mace, smiting a captured slave.
Also, too, we have to look at this, the red crown and the white crown, supposedly of Upper and Lower Egypt. But did they really represent Upper and Lower Egypt? Or just did they represent different aspects of royalty, like graduating from a prince to a high prince or to a priest? It's possible there was a unification, but what if there wasn't? What if these crowns actually masked some physical feature, like an elongated skull?
On the opposite side is an exaggerated figure of Nama.
And he's about 2 or 3 times as big as a normal person, say 10 to 15 feet in height. Now, the Egyptologists put forward the reason for this is because it represents the position of the king. Could it be possible that he actually was that tall? We've got examples of people like Goliath in the Bible, who was a giant. So were many of the gods in many of the ancient mythologies. So was Nama a god or even a demigod, a direct descendant from the gods of the Zeptepi? Surely that has to be possible.
Beside his head, the catfish and chisel supposedly represent his name, and behind him in a rectangle is a pyramid.
Now, there's only 2 conclusions that can come from this. One is that the time of Nama was much later and is part of perhaps the 3rd or 4th dynasty, which doesn't seem plausible. The only other alternative is that these pyramids with this enclosure around it was actually present in the 1st dynasty. And that changes a lot. According to the Egyptologists, the 1st pyramid didn't appear until the 3rd dynasty, the best part of 400 years later. Which means that either the palette didn't belong to Nama, who on this side wears the red crown of Lower Egypt, or it means, and my money's on the latter, that there was at least one pyramid around at the beginning of the 1st dynasty. possibly more.
The central scene represents two men restraining on leashes long-necked animals referred to as serpopods by one source. What is the significance? Are they long-necked lions, spotless leopards, or some sort of hybrid creature left over from the age of the dinosaurs? The tying together of the necks of the two animals has often been interpreted by Egyptologists as a symbol for the tying together of the Upper and Lower Egypt. However, there is nothing to indicate that the animals are symbols of Upper or Lower Egypt, or of which is which. And in fact, the two men are not tying them together. They are restraining them, effectively keeping them apart.
I find the flip side of this palette rather extraordinary, because here we have these two long-necked creatures, possibly dinosaurs, possibly mammals, who knows what they are. But wouldn't it have been easier to just use two giraffes with their long necks entwined? What's the significance of these animals? And more importantly, why are they being restrained by people? If this was a unification, why would these two beasts, these two animals, be on leashes? Now, according to the Egyptologists, the Nama palette represents the unification of Upper and Lower Egypt.
This led to a series of dynasties that ruled Egypt for the next three millennia. Conventionally, ancient Egypt spans the period from the early pre-dynastic settlements of the northern parts of the Nile Valley around 3300 BC through to the conquest of the Romans in 30 BC and its gradual demise. Specifically, it focuses on the history of the pharaohs or the pharaonic period, which is dated from when the Lower and the Upper Egypt supposedly became a unified state around 3150 BC, until the country finally fell under Greek rule in 332 BC and on into the Roman occupation. Certainly nothing to note before 3500 BC, especially not the Zeptepi, or First Times, a mythological golden age when the gods lived amongst humanity together with demigod offspring of the gods and the humans.
In fact, most Egyptologists pay no heed to the Zeptepi, fobbing it off, saying that there's no evidence to support that it existed, even though the ancient Egyptians themselves constantly refer to it.
And left many records describing the Zeptepi as an actual historic time where an advanced race of people came to the Nile Valley and proceeded to civilize and rule over the previously existing local inhabitants. To most Egyptologists, the Zeptepi plays no part in the archaeological history of ancient Egypt as it is currently understood, and therefore, on the whole, they ascribe the Zeptepi no archaeological validity and consequently no time period.
This, despite the fact that the ancient Egyptians themselves refer to the gods of the Zeptepi as having built the Sphinx and the Great Pyramids at Giza.
That construction happening sometime before the Great Deluge, not Cheops and Khafre in the 4th dynasty, as Egyptologists continuously would have us believe. So, are the Egyptologists wrong, or just misinformed? Or are they scared to speak the truth? Typically, the Egyptologists prefer to focus on the history of pharaonic civilization based on the schedule of kingdoms, periods and dynasties first proposed by Manetho, an ancient Greek, in his Egyptica, History of Egypt, written sometime in the 3rd century BC, the Ptolemaic era. It is worth noting that the ancient Egyptians didn't make such subdivisions or group their pharaohs in any such criteria, just Manetho and subsequently the majority of modern Egyptologists. According to Manetho, before 3200 BC and the rule of Menes or Nama, first pharaoh of the first dynasty, there were 10 Thinite kings who ruled for 3050 years. Before them were 30 Memphite kings who ruled for a total of 1827 years. And before them was the reign of the demigods and heroes, including Ares, Anubis, Hercules, Apollo, Amun, and Zeus, that stretched back another 1,255 years. This was in turn preceded by an era called the Reign of the Dead Spirits, which immediately followed the Great Flood and whose length was equal to 3,482 years.
That takes the history of ancient Egypt back to at least 10,164 BC, to the time of a great flood.
Possibly Noah's flood, referred to in the Bible. And a civilization that old was further confirmed by other ancient and classical writers, such as Plato, who spent 13 years in Egypt consulting the scribes and records in the Library of Alexandria, along the way discovering religious hymns apparently written by Isis that were over 10,000 years old.
But wait, folks, there's more to this, because according to Manetho,
before the reign of the dead spirits, the gods had ruled Egypt for 13,900 years, amongst them Horus, Osiris, Isis, Ra, Ptah, and of course Thoth. That was the Zeptepi, the first time before the Great Flood, and it meant that Egyptian chronology extended back even further into prehistory to at least 24,000 BC.
But the history of ancient Egypt doesn't stop there.
Simplicus, in the 6th century, found evidence of astronomical observations reaching back several tens of thousands of years. And Laertius Diogenes, who probably lived between 200 and 300 AD, stated in his only surviving text, Lives and the Opinions of Eminent Philosophers, that Egyptian astronomers possessed observations of 373 solar eclipses and 832 lunar eclipses that extended back 48,863 years before the lifetime of Alexander the Great.
That takes the history of Egypt back to at least 49,195 BC. There is a history that the Egyptologists are just not considering. And the evidence is there. That said, I have to start somewhere. And the conventional history of ancient Egypt, as defined by the Egyptologists, is a good place to start.
The first two ruling dynasties of a unified Egypt set the stage for the Old Kingdom period around 2700 to 2200 BC, which constructed many pyramids, most notably the 3rd dynasty pyramid of Djoser and the 4th dynasty Giza pyramids.
The big question has to be asked, if the pyramids were built in the Old Kingdom during the 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th dynasties, what happened that suddenly they stopped? And why were they built in the arrangements they were made in? What was the location? Why was it so significant? And why does that not correlate with the dynasties themselves? It would make much more sense if there's a different story that goes with that. And in the later episode, we're going to have a look at the evidence that supports a different alternative.
The first intermediate period was a miserable time for Egypt, with the land divided into 3 kingdoms with ineffective and bickering local administrators based in Memphis, Heracleopolis, and Thebes. When drought spread famine and disease, the lack of a central government fermented civil unrest and ushered in a time of political upheaval for about 150 years. Stronger Nile floods and stabilization of government, however, brought back renewed prosperity for the country in the Middle Kingdom around 2040 BC, reaching a peak during the reign of Amenemhat III. But the death of the pharaoh Maneferu I left a vacuum, and with no single king laying claim to both Upper and Lower Egypt, the Middle Kingdom period collapsed, and Egypt fell again into decentralization and fragmentation. Egypt has endured and at times assimilated various foreign influences, including Greek, Persian, Roman, Arab, Ottoman, and European. This second period of disunity heralded the arrival of the first foreign ruling dynasty in Egypt, that of the Semitic Hyksos, who took over much of Lower Egypt around 1650 BC and founded the 14th dynasty and a new capital at Avaris. It is unclear exactly what led to the initial bloodshed, but they were driven out by an Upper Egyptian force led by Amhos I, who founded the 18th dynasty and relocated the capital from Memphis to Thebes. Thus, the new kingdom, around 1550 to 1070 BC, began with the 18th dynasty, marking the rise of Egypt as an international power that expanded during the greatest extension to an empire as far south as Nubia and included parts of the Levant in the east. This period is noted for some of the most well-known pharaohs, including Hatshepsut, Thutmose III, Akhenaten and his wife Nefertiti, Tutankhamun, and Ramses II. The country was later invaded and conquered by Libyans, Nubians, and Assyrians, but native Egyptians eventually drove them out and regained control of their country. In 525 BC, the Persians began their conquest of Egypt, eventually capturing the pharaoh Psamtik III at a battle of Pelusium. Almost the entire 27th dynasty of Egypt, from 525 BC to 402 BC, was an entire Persian-ruled period. The 30th dynasty was the last native ruling dynasty during the Pharaonic epoch. It fell to the Persians again in 343 BC, after the last native pharaoh, King Necht-Nebo II, was defeated in battle. This 31st dynasty of Egypt, however, did not last long, and the Persians were toppled several decades later by Alexander the Great, which marked the Ptolemaic period in Egypt, which in turn led to its overthrow by the Romans in 30 BC.
I'm going to take a really good look at this dynastic system that was set up by Manetho in the 3rd century BC. What was his rationale for these divisions? Because even the experts can't figure out what these delineations are about. But I've got some clues and I've got some ideas, and I think we're going to be able to get a much clearer picture of what this dynastic flow really represented. More than that, we're going to go before the dynasties start. We're going to look at the pre-dynastic period, right back to the Zeptepi, and understand who the gods really were and what's the significance of that lineage all the way through the whole dynastic period. We're going to look at who Nama was and why he was the first pharaoh, who Doja was and the step pyramid. What's the significance of that site? And is it really a third dynasty site, or is it just being built on in the third dynasty? We're going to have a look at the pyramid builders of the fourth, fifth dynasties, right through into the sixth dynasties and the end of that early kingdom. We're then going to go through and we're going to have a look at the new kingdom and the significance of the new kingdom, the significance of the Ptolemaic era and the Romans. There is so much that we're going to look at in this with totally different eyes, not the eyes that the Egyptologists would have us believe, but with fresh eyes, looking at the evidence and what it really tells us.
What better place to start our journey, to start our search for the truth, than here in Cairo at the Egyptian Museum? Now, I can't show you what's inside, because if I wanted to film, I would have to pay tens of thousands of dollars to get access. And I'm not the BBC, and I'm not the Discovery Channel, but we are allowed to film out here in the grounds, so I can show you some of the footage and some of the things of great interest out here.
Built around 1902, after the previous one had been inundated by a flooding Nile, many of the 120,000 artifacts housed in and around the museum, ranging from small baubles and beads to mummies, sarcophagi and statues, had been acquired and accumulated during the tenure of Auguste Mariette, a draftsman, architect and amateur Egyptologist who was appointed conservator of Egyptian monuments in 1858. Over his 30-odd years in control, he systematically excavated over 35 sites, including Abydos, Luxor, Dendera, Edfu, Karnak, Medinet, Habu, and Deir el-Bari. He was also responsible for discovering and excavating the Serapeum at Saqqara, as well as digging out the Sphinx at Giza and discovering the temple before it. Because of his position, Mariette had sole access to the sites, blocking any German or English explorations and excavations, thus enabling him to plunder the site of all he could find, surrendering the pickings to the Khedive and the bulk of the remainder to be split between the French government, the Louvre, and his own interests.
I don't believe Mariette was a true archaeologist as the historians would have us believe. Certainly not by modern standards. He was more of a treasure and glory hunter. You couldn't really call the treasure seekers and thieves of the late 18th century and early 19th centuries Egyptologists, for whilst they may have had an interest in ancient Egypt, it seemed to be more for financial gain or in the realm of exotic collectors. I can't begin to imagine what real treasures have been removed from Egypt and not seen the public gaze since they were first unearthed in the 19th century.
Now that gives us a little bit of look of what's outside, but let's see what sort of clues we can find inside. Let's go.
After checking out the Nama palette for myself, I headed left, following the chronological lineage of the dynasties, starting with the early dynastic period. There were sarcophagi, statues, including a large statue about 12 foot tall, made of time-worn red granite, that was so worn I couldn't make out any of the features, just its general morphology as being human, or perhaps even humanoid. There was no label as to who it was, or even where it was from. So how did the Egyptologists know it belonged to the early dynastic period? It could have been from hundreds or even thousands of years earlier. There were bits of walls and doorways hacked from their original temple sites, all stuck up for display like trophies, but little or no labelling of the artefacts. And where there are labels, they'd been typed on an old typewriter, which is an indication of how long it had been since there was any real attempt at presenting the exhibits in an informed manner. There are no diagrams or maps showing from where they've been hacked, and no translations of the hieroglyphic text carved into them. Perhaps this will be rectified once the new museum is opened. But this hodgepodge of guesswork is an indication of the foundations of Egyptology. At the first corner, I arrived at the Old Kingdom, the supposed pyramid building period of the 3rd to 6th dynasties. There were lots of shrine-like walls that looked like doorways, few more statues, including a seated figure of Doja, the second pharaoh of the 3rd dynasty, and a diorite statue of Khephren, or Khafre, who was the 4th pharaoh of the 4th dynasty. It was like I was walking the corridors of some sort of dismembered family mausoleum. There was virtually nothing from the 1st intermediate period, that's the 7th to 10th dynasties, and then suddenly you're traversing the left corridor that comprises objects from the Middle Kingdom, the 11th to 14th dynasties, including numerous larger-than-life statues of Senreset I, who was the second pharaoh of the 12th dynasty. There was also a complete tomb chamber that possibly belonged to Rahotep, the second pharaoh of the 17th dynasty, but again, without any labelling, I could easily have been mistaken. Further on, there's nothing of any relevance from the second intermediate period, especially from the 15th and 16th dynasties of the Hyksos invaders. And by the time I'd reached the back corridor and entered into the new kingdom, the exhibits from the 18th to 20th dynasties, I was starting to feel, with so much of this having been lifted from the actual sites, that going to visit the temples and tombs up the river may turn out to be a bit of an anticlimax. We'll have to wait and see. Amongst the other artifacts, there was a statue of Thutmose III as a young man wearing the crown of Upper Egypt, a chapel of Hathor, a statue of Hathor dedicated by Thutmose III, and a stela of Amenhotep III. Continuing along the back corridor, I passed a small sphinx with Hatshepsut's name on it, and then, at the back centre of the museum, the Amarna period of the 18th dynasty, focusing on Akhenaten, the heretic pharaoh. Standing about 14 or 15 foot tall were several reconstructed statues of Akhenaten that had been unearthed in the temple complex at Karnak. Now clearly this was no ordinary being. An elongated face and head, large armoured eyes, big pointy sort of ears rising above where a normal human set of ears would be. This guy looked more like Mr. Spock from Star Trek than an Egyptian. And Akhenaten's body was weirdly distorted. With a small, sunken chest but wide hourglass hips, he looked more reminiscent of a Jenny Craig dropout with excessive saddlebags. If you believe the Egyptologists, then Akhenaten's strange appearance is all the result of him having a recessive genetic order called Marfone syndrome. Strangely enough, though, this disorder also seems to have caused giantism. But the Egyptologists say that's because he was a pharaoh, so he was depicted larger. What a load of bollocks. The simple reason is because, just like Nama, he was twice as tall as everybody else. And as for the recessive genes, how do the Egyptologists explain them passed on to his offspring? Well, that means Nefertiti must have suffered the same disease. And though the royal's definitely interbred, that whole recessive gene scenario just doesn't add up for me. There was also a granite head of Ramses II from the 19th dynasty, a few figures of gods and sacred animals, some papyrus texts in glass cases, again with no translations, a head of the 30th dynasty pharaoh Taharqa, and then before I knew it, I was through the Greek pharaohs, the Ptolemies, a sea of sarcophagi, and through the Romans, and back to where I'd entered the museum. But from there I could look directly back down the centre to the Amarna section. And through the middle, there were several granite capstones of several pyramids, some granite sarcophagi, a magnificent full-painted floor from the palace of Akhenaten at Amarna, and several other statues from the 18th dynasty. But beyond them was this colossal statue of Amenhotep III with his wife Queen Tai, supposedly the mother of Akhenaten and grandmother of Tutankhamun. Although seated majestically upon their thrones, fully standing, Amenhotep III and his wife must have been over 15 foot tall. And there was something about Queen Tai's hair, not so much the style, but the shape of the head it concealed, that implied she had a massive skull extending back and to the side. So was she an alien? And if she was, did that mean Akhenaten was as well? And if they were, then that sheds a completely new light on the whole history of ancient Egypt. Heading up the stairs to the floor above, there were rows and rows of wooden mummy cases, most about 5 to 6 feet long. But then I spotted several mummy cases nearly 15 foot long, one of which apparently belonged to Queen Tai. Now the Egyptologists propose that it was an outer casing and that several other wooden cases would have been inside. But something about that just doesn't ring true. Maybe it was the fact that there was a solid stone statue about the same size on the floor below. At the end of the rows of wooden coffins was glass case after glass case filled with tiny statuettes, household artifacts, arrows, jars, baubles, beads, most of them all unlabeled. And heading into the extensive Tutankhamun section at the rear of the first floor, there were impressive shrines, the chariots, the beds, and of course the famous death mask. Further along, the mummy room contained a collection of 3,500-year-old linen-wrapped mummies, all preserved to the hilt, most of whom the Egyptologists didn't really know their true identities. They were just making educated guesses. It was like a morgue for ancient nameless nomads. Before leaving the museum, I took a look at perhaps one of the most important stones in ancient history. That's the Rosetta Stone.
The Rosetta Stone, a slab of diorite or basalt, just over a meter high, 70 centimeters wide, and as deep as 28 centimeters, is one of the most important pieces of rock in Egypt. A Ptolemaic era stele from around 196 BC, with carved texts of a single passage of royal decree published by Ptolemy V concerning taxes and statue buildings, the original is on public display in the British Museum, having been transferred from French hands in 1801. The decree is in hieroglyphs, Demotic, which is another form of Egyptian, and Classical Greek. Translating the hieroglyphs relies totally on Thomas Young and Jean-François Champollion's 1822 translation of the Rosetta Stone found in 1799.
Most Egyptologists swear by it, but I'm not so accepting that it's a perfect translation. What if Champollion made mistakes? What if they all made mistakes? What if they had preconceived ideas or beliefs that blocked them from seeing what was really indicated? Numerous people have suggested that Champollion's work was weak, that it was short, that it was non-scientific, and it was full of incorrect assumptions. More recent research goes to the correlation between Egyptian hieroglyphs and Meroitic hieroglyphs, which is a language from Sudan and very similar to the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs. And who made the Rosetta Stone in the first place? We know it dates from the Ptolemaic era, but that's up to 3,000 years after the first hieroglyphs. Language can change a hell of a lot of time. Just have a look at the difference between Shakespeare and Puff Daddy, and that's only 500 years. What if the Ptolemaic scribes made mistakes? Slip of the chisel here, turning a word sacred into scared, or perhaps they creatively edited the text to reflect their own slant on the agendas of the day. What if they all made mistakes? And this is what modern Egyptologists are relying on in their translations. The translations only have to be slightly different to have a different meaning. For instance, if I say, you are to be married. But if I've left out a word, you are not to be married, it changes the whole context. How can we be sure that what we're reading is being properly translated? The development of language in the globe over centuries and centuries has taken many different paths. But basically they take two. The first one is cursive. It's some sort of writing or scratching out of letters. The second is more image-based. For instance, the Korean, the Japanese, and the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs come from this image-based source. Now, where does that derive from? We have two sides of the brain. One side is our analytical brain, and one side is our creative brain. The images all come from the creative brain. That's the right brain. The logic side comes from the left side of our brain. The two different sides of the brain, one can dominate the other. So if we've got the left brain dominating, meaning I'm right-handed, I will write most likely from right to left, so that I'm not destroying what I'm writing, especially if I'm writing in ink, or if I'm chiseling, I'm writing that way. If the other side of my brain is working, I'm going to write from right to left. And we have languages that are right to left, and we have languages that are left to right, indicating that one part of the brain is probably dominating more than the other in these developments. So where does Egyptian language fit in. We don't have anyone alive today who can read ancient hieroglyphics, despite the fact the language only died out maybe 2,000 years ago. So we can speculate, and there's been a lot of speculation about translating Egyptian hieroglyphs. In particular, most people rely on the translations of Young and Champollion. What if they all made mistakes? And this is what modern Egyptologists are relying on in their translations. Finally, there's the issue of dates, and in particular the calendars that relate to those dates, specifically the terms BC and AD. For example, let's look at the terminology BC. Now, most of us accept that that is before Christ, but that's not actually the case.
In classical antiquity, the Hellenic calendar, particularly the Ptolemaic calendar of 238 BC, inspired the later Roman calendar, including the solar Julian calendar introduced in 45 BC. But the terms BC and AD did not come about until much, much later.
Nothing dated before Christ, BC, would actually have the letters BC after it. How do you date something 1500 BC when BC means before Christ? It was 1500 years before Christ was even born, so how could you know that?
Christianity became the official religion of Rome in the second half of the 4th century, around the year 380. But it wasn't until AD 525 that a Roman Christian monk named Dionysius Exiguus set up the AD system to replace the Era of Martyrs system, which had numbered the years from the ascension of Diocletian in 248. Diocletian was responsible for launching the last yet most severe persecution of Christians, and because Dionysius did not wish to continue the memory of a tyrant who persecuted Christians, he replaced the Era of Martyrs with the AD system, Anno Domini, being from Anni Domini Nostri Jesus Christi, which means in the year of the Lord. Dionysius did so by using biblical texts and working backwards to estimate when he thought Jesus was born. One major theory is that Dionysius based his calculations on the Gospel of Luke, which states that Jesus was about 30 years old, shortly after the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, and hence subtracted 30 years from that date. However, there is a general agreement amongst scholars Dionysius guessed incorrectly. Most theologians and religious historians believe that Jesus was born sometime between 7 and 4 BC. That said, some scholars rely on John 8:57, "Thou art not yet 50 years old," making the earliest possible year for Jesus' birth 18 BC. There are even estimates the birth of Jesus was as early as the 2nd century BC, or as late as 4 AD. The label Anno Domini is thus arguably the most inaccurate, simply because the historical evidence is too sketchy to allow a definite dating and raises numerous thorny theological issues should we say that Christ was actually born 4, 7 or 18 years before Christ.
If we allow for a margin of error of say 10%, and we're talking about a date that is 5,000 years old, that's 500 years gap, and that's a long time in history for things to change. So these guesstimates of dates, whilst they may be accurate, may also be inaccurate, and they could be out by anything up to 100 years. So we have to take it with a grain of salt and look at all of the evidence to see what the truth is. If we look at the terminology BC, let's take the year 1 AD. Now, if everything is supposed to start with the birth of Jesus Christ, and we're using the Julian calendar, or the later development of that, the Gregorian calendar, then why is it that the Romans, who developed the Julian calendar, started the year 1 with the birth of somebody that they supposedly crucified as a heretic. The Egyptologists will argue on the contrary. They'll say that they can work out from this document or that document roughly what the year is. And that's true. But in the end, they are guessing, because there are no definitive documents that can delineate what year BC and what year AD.
Though Dionysus introduced the new era dating system in 525, it was not widely used until after 800. In the meantime, about 700 AD, Bede the Venerable called the time after AD Ante Uero Incarnationis Dominicae Tempus, which is Latin for the time before the Lord's true incarnation, the English equivalent to that Latin phrase being before Christ. Our current calendar, the Gregorian calendar, and the year numbering system associated with it was introduced as a reform on the Julian calendar in 1582.
Why is it that the Romans based their calendar entirely on the birth of somebody that they crucified? Now, later on, Christianity was adopted as their religion. But they didn't change the year dates. It didn't suddenly go from, oh, now we've adopted Christianity, we're going to backdate everything to his birth. The Julian calendar was already in existence. So whose birth was it really based on? Because it couldn't have been based on Jesus. Because he was persecuted and he was crucified. And that does not make sense at all. So we're going to investigate that whole issue.
It was Julius Caesar who introduced the Julian calendar on January 1st, 45 BC, replacing the previous lunar-based calendar with the Ptolemaic Egyptian solar calendar he had obtained from his relationship with Cleopatra VII, which added 3 months and set the length of the year to 365.25 days by adding an intercalary or leap day at the end of February every fourth year. A calendar almost identical to the current Western Gregorian calendar introduced in 1582.
So really, our current calendar must have started back in 45 BC. But what evidence do we have to support that? And what evidence aligns that date with the birth of Jesus?
Julius Caesar was assassinated the following year on the 15th of March 44 BC. And according to Suetonius, 4 months after Caesar's assassination, during the festival known as the Ludi Victoriae Caesaris, the games held in Caesar's honor, as celebrations were getting underway, a comet shone for 7 successive days, rising above the 11th hour, and was believed to be the soul of Caesar. Caesar's comet, or the Great Comet of 44 BC, as it is also known, was perhaps the most famous comet of antiquity. In fact, the bright daylight visible comet may have been the brightest daylight comet in recorded history, and was interpreted by the Romans as a sign of the deification of the recently assassinated dictator. Thus, the comet was known to the ancient writers as the Sidus Iulium, the Julian star, or Caesaris Astrum, the star of Caesar.
Was this the origins of the Star of Bethlehem? And was this the star that led the three wise kings to the birth of Jesus?
Subsequently, on November 27, 43 BC, the Second Triumvirate was officially formed, composed of Mark Antony, Octavian, and Caesar's loyal commander Lepidus. It formally deified Caesar as Divus Iulius on 1st of January 42 BC, and Caesar's successor and adopted son Octavian henceforth became Divi Filius, the son of God.
So, was Octavian the real son of God? No, he couldn't have been, because he wasn't a blood relative, he was adopted. The real son of God was Caesar's real son, Caesarion, who he had with Cleopatra the VII, and Caesarion was born coincidentally 5 years earlier in 47 BC. Could the real Jesus be Caesarion, who was then the potential heir to both the Roman empires and the Egyptian empires? Is that why the three kings traveled from the east to pay homage to his birth? Have we discovered the biggest deception in history? Let's get into that, right into that, in a later episode.
Well, I don't know about you, but that was pretty exciting. And if you're ever coming here to Cairo, make sure that you go to the museum and have a look around. There's some good feelings and bad feelings about that. You've got all of these wonderful pieces here together, but there's something about them not being in their original location that detracts from the truth about their origins. Now, we found some great secrets out in there, but I think there are even bigger secrets to be found back at the original locations. So let's now take our journey right up to Upper Egypt, to the beginnings of the Nile, and let's see what we find.
My thoughts are just that, they're my thoughts. And if the Egyptologists can conjecture and put things together any way that they want, then why can't I? Why can't any of us? And that's what we're going to do. We're going to have a look at the evidence in ancient Egypt. We're going to visit the temples, we're going to visit the pyramids, and we're going to look at it all with fresh eyes. And we're going to come to some different conclusions that may change the whole history of the planet. In the next episode, I'm going to Abu Simbel to examine the real history behind the building of the high dam at Aswan. Who was really behind it, and what was their real agenda? The answers will rock you to your core.